Hello everyone, thank you all for coming. My name is Shalin Mangar. I work at Lucidworks and I work almost full time on Apache Solr, focusing specifically on Solr Cloud and finding its bugs, hardening it, testing it to its limits, you know, and doing that over and over again. So in this talk, we're going to talk about Jepsen and flaky networks. What is Jepsen? I'll come to that in a bit. Sorry about that. Let's start with what do I mean by a flaky network? So this is from Jeff Dean, who works at Google at Lattice 2009. Admittedly, the stats are a little bit old, but the message is still true today. In their experience, in the first year of a new cluster, a cluster has about between 40 to 80 machines, about 5 racks have problems in which there is a packet loss of almost 50%. So 50% of the servers can randomly not be able to talk to each other. And you have network maintenance events in which you have sporadic connectivity issues between servers, router failures, DNS issues, whatnot, right? And this is Google. These guys know a few things about running large clusters, right? So the fact is that reliable networks are a myth. They don't exist. When you have asynchronous communication happening in a data center, things will go bad. And it's not just the network. It's not just the network equipment which goes faulty. It's also your systems. For example, if you're running Java, you have garbage collection pauses, right? So processes which will fail to send a message or respond to a message because they are in a garbage collection pause. And that is not any different from a network partition if you're looking from the outside. Right? If I'm trying to send an HTTP request to a server which is in a garbage collection pause, it's not any different than if there was a bad firewall rule which prevented the packets from reaching that server. There is no difference between the two. Right? So network partitions are a reality. It's not just the network equipment which goes bad. It is process crashes. It is the scheduling delays of the Linux kernel. For example, you're running your systems in a cloud on AWS or other shared hardware, right, with virtualization. And if the other virtual machines on that same physical host are very busy and the scheduler decides to give more priority to some other virtual machine, then the same thing happens. Your processes cannot run. They'll be paused until the scheduler comes back and gives them priority, right? So when we talk about network partitions, most people think that the network partition happens something like this. So this is a 5-node cluster. So I've named the machines N1, N2, up to N5. And this dotted line in the middle can be a bad firewall rule. It can be a faulty switch which refuses to send packets across. It can even be a garbage collection pause happening on N4 and N5, keeping them completely separate from talking to the other nodes in the cluster, right? But this is not the whole truth. This is not the only way that network partitions happen. In an asynchronous network, it is allowed that packets can be lost, they can be completely dropped, they can be duplicated, they can be reordered, and they can be delayed, right? And if the delay is too much, what do you get? In your applications, you have timeouts, you have connection timeouts, you have read timeouts, right? So all these things are allowed in asynchronous networks, right? So when you have these kind of things, how do you figure out what a distributed system is supposed to do in the presence of these kind of problems? So let's come back to a topic which has been discussed at least twice yesterday in different talks, the CAP theorem. The CAP theorem says that you have consistency, availability, and partition tolerance, and you can choose only two, right? And this has been discussed to death yesterday and in literature and you know, in different research papers as well. So what is consistency according to the CAP theorem? Actually, the CAP theorem is very, very specific about the kind of consistency it requires. It requires linearizable consistency. What that means is, from an external client, all operations that are happening in a system are supposed to happen, they should look like they are happening at the same instant, okay? Even though they are not happening exactly at the same instant in the presence of concurrent read and update requests, but from an outside perspective, they should look like they're happening at the same instant, okay? Availability basically means that every request which is received by a non-failing node should respond. It does not say how soon should it respond. There is no time bound on it. But it does say that there is a finite time bound. It's not like you can just give up and not respond at all. So you should respond at some point, but it does not say how soon you should respond. And then you have partition tolerance. What that means is, during a partition, an arbitrary number of messages may be dropped. It only talks about dropping messages. It does not talk about reordering messages or delaying messages, whatever. Well, the delay is actually quite similar to a drop, but let's not go there for a moment. So partition tolerance says that unless the complete network is shut down, there should never be an incorrect response coming back from a machine. But when it comes to real systems that we use, real data stores and databases that we use, like Cassandra, Elastic, Solr, Mongo, Redis, etc., etc., how does that manifest practically to your applications? When you choose to forego availability, so partition tolerance is a must, right? You cannot not choose partition tolerance. A system should not, I mean, if you, partitions are going to happen no matter what you do, no matter how reliable your systems are, right? So if you, you must choose to tolerate partitions. So which means you can either give up consistency or you can give up availability for different operations. And it's not a hard and fast rule that you have to do it for all kinds of operations. So different systems can choose different kinds of guarantees for different kinds of operations. But when you choose to forego availability, then what happens? Either the server or your data store responds with an error saying, you know, I'm not available right now, maybe try again later. Or you might not find a route to that host, so you get connection timeouts. Or maybe that host is actually trying to make a call to a resource on some other node, in which case your request can be hung for a long time and you can have timeouts in your applications. At the same time, if your data store forgoes consistency, then what happens? You can get stale results, so basically results which are out of date, which have been overwritten by another process on some other part of the data store, on some other machine. Or you can have dirty reads. What is a dirty read? A dirty read is a read which is showing incorrect or garbage data. For example, a system might choose to give the client a new response, a new data, even though that new data has not been acknowledged back to the original guy who wrote that data. So that is a dirty read. So some systems can do that. The third thing is, and the most catastrophic thing is, it loses your data. The data which you added, which you updated to the system, and you got back an acknowledgement from that system is now no longer there at all. It's just gone, right? So this is like the most catastrophic kind of a failure when you forego consistency. How do you plan for these things? To plan for these things, you first have to figure out whether your data store actually exhibits these behaviors and which behaviors does it exhibit. Now, a lot of the literature, a lot of the documentation for different data stores, sometimes it's not complete, sometimes it's a little hand-wavy, you know, not very precise, or sometimes it's not present at all. And the only way you can actually know the guarantees of your systems is by testing them. So how do you test for these kind of problems? And that is where Jepsen comes in. So Jepsen is a tool written by a guy called Kyle Kingsbury, who goes by the handle of Afir online. And he has written prolifically about different data stores. He wrote this tool in Clojure. What this tool does is, it tries to set up a small 5-node cluster, and then it tries to wreak havoc on that cluster by either using IP tables to drop packets, or to delay packets, or to SSH into those individual boxes and crashing the processes without giving any warnings, or maybe pausing and restarting those processes. Or maybe it can even do things like go in and change the clock of the system, or go in or flip the bits on the disk for the different data stores, right? So it allows you to create very, very powerful tests, which you can use then to test on your own systems. So what does a typical Jepsen test look like? A typical Jepsen test has these components. First of all, you have a bit of code to set up that data store. This data store can be Cassandra, Mongo, whatever you want to test, right? So you will set up this in an automated fashion and you can tear it down. So what we typically do is, for example, how I test it is I have this one large desktop machine with 8 cores and 32 gigs of RAM. Well, it's not that big now, but it was big 4 years back when I built it. And inside that, I have Linux containers running. So I have 5 nodes running as different Linux containers. In each of these 5 nodes, I set up Solr. And I have these clients which are running as part of the Jepsen process on the host machine, right? And this host machine has permissions to go and SSH into each of these Linux containers so that we can do these kind of operations, right? So you have the automated database setup. You have the client or the test definition. And we are going to talk about that in a bit. You have something called a nemesis, which is the guy who creates chaos. It's like a chaos monkey kind of a thing, right? So it creates chaos in your cluster. Then you have a schedule of operations. So you can say, you know, I'm going to write a new data or a new document every 1 second. Then I'm going to wait for a random amount of time. And maybe after every 30 seconds, I'm going to create a partition between nodes and then heal that partition after another minute or so. Okay? And I'm going to do that repeatedly for maybe 5 minutes or 10 minutes or whatever. Okay? So you have the schedule of operations. Whenever the client makes a request, whenever the client invokes an operation on the host, which is running on the Linux container, you either get back an OK response, a success, or a failure, or it times out, which is basically ambiguous. It could either have succeeded and you did not know about it, or it could have failed. So you have to treat that as an ambiguous response. It can either be a success or a failure message. So all these success, failure, and indeterminate responses are logged, which we call as the history of operations. And this history of operations is important because that lets you figure out what should have been the final state of the system under the guarantees that are provided by that data store. Okay? And then you have a consistency checker, which basically figures out whether the final read was consistent or whether it lost data or whether there is some extra garbage which we never actually put in the first place. So the first three things are data store specific. So if you're testing Mongo, you'll write drivers, a client for Mongo. You'll write the automated setup code for Mongo and the nemesis types. Some of the nemesis are actually provided by Jepsen, and we're going to talk about that in a bit. But this part is data store specific. So if you're going to test something of your own, you're going to write this part in Clojure according to your own data store. And then these three things are provided by Jepsen. So you have these three nodes, which are created using Linux containers. You have these three clients, which are created inside the Jepsen process. They make requests concurrently to these different nodes, and they get responses which can be OK or failure or indeterminate. And collectively, these responses are known as the history of the system. Okay. Now, what is a nemesis? So the dictionary describes a nemesis as the inescapable agent of someone's downfall. And this inescapable agent of someone's downfall, that someone is your data store. It could be Mongo or Solr or whatever, right? So let's look at a few of those nemesis that are provided by Jepsen for you. So the first one is pretty simple. It's called the partition random node. It will randomly choose a node from your existing cluster, and it will SSH into that box and use IP tables to drop all external traffic. So both incoming and outgoing. So that node will neither receive any traffic, nor it will be able to send any requests out of it, right? The second one is very similar, but instead of using IP tables, it will just go inside that node and do a kill -9. It will just kill it without any warning at all, right? And then it will do all these tests. The third one would be it will go and change the clock. It will change the clock, maybe make it 5 minutes before, 5 minutes afterwards, or whatever. You can actually specify the threshold of how much the clock is supposed to change. Then you can get into more complicated tests where you partition halves. So if you have 5 nodes, you will have a majority partition and a minority partition, right? And you can choose them linearly. So you can always say that, hey, N1 and N2 and N3 are going to be together, and N4 and N5 are going to be in a separate partition. Or you can choose them randomly, which is the second one here, the partition random halves. The third one is even more interesting. The third one is called a bridge partition. In this bridge partition, what happens is the node N3 can talk to the nodes on both sides of the partition, but the nodes N1 and N2 cannot talk to N4, N5, and vice versa, right? So this is a very, very tricky sort of a partition. And it's not like that this partition doesn't happen. This partition can also happen in physical and real networks. So how do we write the client? How do we test? What are we actually going to test? So this is a simple test that I used for Solr. It was originally written for Elastic by the guy who wrote Jepsen, and we adapted the same test to test Solr as well. So in this case, what we're going to do is we're going to create one document inside our data store, which is going to keep a list of integers, a set of integers. Okay, so those integers should not repeat. And we are going to use the compare and set primitives available in these data stores to add a new integer to this set, right? So we read the data store, we see that the current version is v1, then we say, you know, add an integer 2 to this set as long as the version is v1, and then you can keep on repeating from each client. Okay, so presumably only one of those compare and set operations should succeed, and whatever has succeeded should never be rolled back, right? So we do this concurrently from each client. So if you're going to set up a 5-node cluster to test, we are going to create 5 clients as well, and we are going to ask them to use multiple threads to write new integers to this set stored in that data store. Okay? And then we'll create and restore partitions in the middle, and when finally all the partitions have healed, we'll go and read the set of values which are stored inside the data store and see if they actually match what should have happened. Okay. So in this case, this is a visual representation of the same thing. You initially have an empty set and you do a compare and set and add the value 1 to the set of integers. So you have the value 1 inside stored as a document inside Solr or Elastic or Mongo or whatever. Then you have two clients which are trying to update, which are trying to add a new value to this set concurrently. So because they're trying to use the same version, one of them will succeed, one of them will fail, right? And then we'll repeat this process again and again. During this time, we will create a partition and then heal the partition. And we'll keep doing this a couple of times to see what happens. So this part, whether the operation succeeded or failed, or was indeterminate, is the history of operations. The history is nothing but the time at which the operation responded back to you, the operation that was actually being performed, and the result of that operation. So, originally the author of Jepsen, he wrote a series of blog posts, which are really good, which you should all go and read about if you're interested in distributed systems. And he did tests on Redis, on Mongo, on Elastic, Zookeeper, Cassandra, Aerospike, Redis, DiskU, a lot of different data stores. He did not test Solr. But when these results came out, a lot of our customers, a lot of people started asking that how well does Solr perform in the face of these kind of partitions. So since it is one of my responsibilities in my job to do these kind of things, so I started learning Clojure. And I started writing these tests, adapting them from the ones that he had written for Elastic and running them on Solr. So this was a process. It took about 2 to 3 months for me. And we found a few bugs, and we did solve those bugs. So this is, I'm going to talk a little bit about what we found and how does it actually perform. And then I'm going to come to other data stores. So Solr, how many of you are familiar with Solr? Okay, a lot of you are familiar with Solr. So a quick recap. Solr is a search server which uses Lucene, not very different from Elastic in that sense. But there are a few differences. For example, Solr uses Zookeeper for distributed consensus. So it relies on a Zookeeper cluster to figure out which node should become a leader, or who is the current leader, or whether a particular node is live or dead, and so on and so forth. It has a Lucene index, so you can add new documents. You can do a full text search on those documents. You can do autocomplete, highlighting, faceting, analytics, so on and so forth. It also has things like compare and set. So you can atomically update a given document by providing the last version that you know about. And if the version is still the same, Solr will go ahead and update the document. Otherwise, it will say, you know, there's a conflict and I cannot update. So presumably, because it provides a comparent set and an atomic primitive, presumably it should be linearizable. Okay. So let's see what happens. When you add a new document to Solr, it is synchronously replicated to all the nodes which are available at that time. So which nodes are live at that time is determined by using Zookeeper. Okay. If you want to read the whole thing, like the complete test methodology and the results and the configuration and everything, so this is a blog post I wrote last year in December. It has all the juicy details. You can go and read it. In this test, I'm going to use a compare and set client. I'm going to simulate a set of integers. I'm going to add an integer every second concurrently from five different clients on five different Solr nodes. And I'm going to partition the network randomly in half every 30 seconds, and I'm going to keep running the partition for 200 seconds. So for 200 seconds, nodes in the majority and minority partition will not be able to talk to each other. Okay. I know you cannot read this, but it's not that important. It's just closure. I wanted to show how I can write closure. So are we actually safe? Does Solr actually do what we want it to do? Well, maybe. The thing is, every application is different. If you are going to use Solr as the only data store, then you're going to have some problems. But we do not have any catastrophic data loss problems which were found in other data stores. What we did find was that when a partition happens, the leaders on the minority partition, they become unavailable for up to the Zookeeper session timeout, which is typically 30 seconds in Solr by default. So for 30 seconds, until the time that Solr realizes that the leaders are no longer reachable from a majority partition, it will not elect a new leader. But after 30 seconds, when the ZK session timeout happens, it will elect a new leader on the majority partition, and then things will continue as they were before. So for that 30 second, or maybe a little bit more or less than that, Solr writes on Solr for the leaders which were on the minority partition will be unavailable. So you can figure out whether that is reasonable for your application or not. So there is no hard and fast rule on these things. Some writes will hang for a long time. And of course, timeouts are essential. So when I say for a long time, they actually hang on for some of these writes, which happened right as the partition was happening, would just go and hang for as long as the partition was kept up, which is pretty bad. But it's not so bad because in your real practical applications, you will set up a timeout for maybe 3 or 4 seconds or something like that. And after that, you'll say, hey, the operation did not succeed, and maybe I'll try again later. So not that a big deal. Under the compare and set operations and under these kind of partitions, the final reads had all the integers for which we got an OK response, plus some extra integers for which we were not able to figure out. For example, the request timed out. So we were not able to figure out whether they failed or whether they succeeded. And some of those actually succeeded, and they were also found in the final set. So on the right-hand side, you have a small snippet of the results which are generated by Jepsen, which says the recovered fraction, and this is a ratio. So which means for 14 requests, the results were ambiguous, and they were actually found in the final results. So the 14 were recovered. 0 were unexpected, so there was no dirty reads. There was nothing which should not have been there, which we never added in the first place. We did not lose any documents. And the OK fraction was 1251 out of 2359 total attempts. So when it comes to availability, well, probably not that great. But then this also depends a lot on the cluster topology that you're testing, right? For example, if you're running just one shard and five replicas, the availability results might be very different than if you're running three shards and five replicas, or five shards and three replicas, right? It all depends on where the leaders of those shards land up and whether they land up in the minority partition or not. So no data loss yet, which is good. But we have not proved a linearizable history. For example, we did not look at the intermediate results and figured out whether the intermediate history was also correct or not. Was there a total order or not? We have not proved that yet. So we'll do that in the later iterations of these tests. But just because we did not find very bad bugs, that doesn't mean they don't exist, right? So we're going to keep looking. So this is now a process. Every time we have a new release coming up in Solr, we run these tests, figure out whether it failed or not, go deep, investigate what happened, what really happened, is that a valid bug or not, what happened, you know, and we just keep doing that all the time for each release. So that's Solr. What were the bugs that were found? So I'm not going to cover this very deeply in this, because you can go and read up on these bugs online if you just search for these things. One very bad bug that we found was that if you are issuing commits on Solr during a partition, it would put randomly, it would just put any node in the down state, and then that node will not receive any traffic from the client. And that's pretty bad. What was happening was that all the writes that are done in Solr are coordinated via the leader, right? But the commits are just broadcasted by any node, because you don't need to be a leader to broadcast a commit. It does not change the actual data which is inside the Solr, right? It just makes it visible. So what was happening was that the node which is broadcasting the commit was also acting as a leader for that operation during that bit of time, and therefore it was able to put another node in a bad state when it could not make a request to that node, right? Which was pretty bad. So we fixed that. Now the commit operations don't go through that code path anymore. The second one was not catastrophic, but it was a bit of an annoyance, really. What was happening was when the nodes reconnected to ZK, it was invoking the startup logic, which is to recover from the transaction log and then become available. And that was not a bad thing. I mean, that was not bad in the way that any operation was being repeated, because all of these operations are stored with their versions in the transaction log. So if you're going to repeat them, it does not change anything at all, because the versions are old. Solr will just discard them. But it takes time to go through that transaction log, which can be hundreds of megabytes, and actually invoke all those operations and then figure out, hey, this was all useless in the first place. Then there were some other, I already talked about the fact that some requests hung around for a long time, which we fixed. The cluster status API of Solr was a little flaky. It used to go to Zookeeper each and every time, which gives you very consistent responses, but during partitions, it tends to hang. So it would, instead of saying that, you know, I cannot go to Zookeeper, it will just hang for a couple of minutes and not give you a response at all, which is bad. So we fixed that in 5.2. The last one was especially tricky to figure out. This was a race condition between how a leader marks a replica is down and the exact time at which the partition happens and so on. So the more juicy details are available on the Jira issues. If you're interested in that, you can go and look it up. Elastic. So Elastic is quite similar to Solr, right? It also uses a Lucene index and a transaction log. It's a full-text search server, not unlike Solr. Promises data safety and consistent single doc reads and compare and set operations. The search is, of course, like Solr, it's eventually consistent. For example, when you commit an operation, that's when the results of the add or update become visible to searchers. So this should also show similar behavior as what Solr exposed, right? But unfortunately, that's not the case. Elastic uses a homegrown algorithm that what they call as Zen Disco. And it's not based on any peer-reviewed consensus algorithm like Paxos or Raft or whatever. I don't know what it actually does, really. I've never looked at the code. But what happens really is when, and this test is not something that I ran myself. This is a test that the guy who wrote Jepsen, Afer, he did these tests. And he wrote a nice blog post summarizing them for version 1.1. That was initially when he wrote the tests. And then again for version 1.5. And in both the cases, he found a lot of data loss issues during different kinds of partitions. And not just during network partitions, but also during garbage collection pauses. So they are getting better between versions, but they're still not quite there. They still have a little work to do. I think if they just use something like Zookeeper, they would avoid a lot of these problems. But they choose not to do that to make it easy to set up, probably. And that bites you in production. OK. Let's come to Mongo. How many of you use Mongo? Okay. And how many of you know about Mongo, like generally? Almost all of you, right? Okay, so Mongo is different, right? It's supposed to be like a proper data store, not a search server like Elastic or Solr. And it's a document-oriented data store, which means you have a document with a list of key-value pairs. The values can be further JSON documents and so on and so forth. And you can nest them. And it provides atomic updates on the documents as well. So it is supposed to be like an alternative to a proper database like MySQL or Postgres or whatever, right? So in theory, it should give you some of the same guarantees that those systems give you, or maybe a little less, right? But what exactly are the guarantees that it gives? So first of all, Mongo does not use anything like Zookeeper or anything. It has basically, you have concept of replica sets who elect a primary and the others become secondary to that primary. All the write operations go to the primary and the operation log is replicated asynchronously to all the secondaries in that replica set. And the replicas decide among themselves when the current leader is to be demoted or when one replica among them is to be promoted as the primary. Okay. And what I'm going to talk about here is applies to versions 2.4.3 and 2.6.7. So the way it figures out whether nodes are up or down is very simple. Every node sends a heartbeat message every 10 seconds. And if a node does not receive heartbeat messages from other node for up to 10 seconds, it determines that, you know, that node is probably down. And if it was the leader, I'm going to demote it and I'm going to promote myself or somebody else and so on and so forth. So it's very simple in that manner. So it claims to have atomic writes per document and it supports fully consistent reads. What is a fully consistent read? So that is again a bit ambiguous. It's not actually fully consistent. When you start reading the documentation, they first say it's like fully consistent. But then when you come down later in the documentation, it says that if you want strict consistency, you should always read from the primary because the updates are replicated asynchronously to the secondaries, right? If you're reading from secondary, you might get some stale data which has already been changed on the primary. Okay, can you guys still hear me? Okay. So presumably, if we write to if we always read from the primary, then we should be safe, right? But that's not the complete story. There is something called a write concern in Mongo, which has different levels. So when you're writing a document to Mongo, you can specify one or more of these write concerns, and it will do things accordingly. In 2.4.3, MongoDB used simple UDP messages to send data one way to the server and just forget about it. It would not even know whether the server received that request at all or whether it acknowledged it. So it was like completely unsafe. So they changed it after AFIR published a blog post on MongoDB. And now they use something called an acknowledged write concern, which means that the primary acknowledges to the client that, yes, I have written this data, but this data is only written in memory. It's not actually journaled to the op log or written to its actual file formats. So it's not on the disk, it's just in memory. Which also means that if the primary goes down before the data can be replicated to the secondaries, your document might be lost, right? Which is bad. So you have write concern journaled, fsynced, replicas acknowledged, and then something called majority, which means it's gonna acknowledge that the write actually has been sent and acknowledged by the majority of the replicas. So this is supposed to be like the safe setting, right? So this should be perfectly safe. But is that true? No, not really. What happens is that when you're writing to a majority, so first of all, if you're not even writing to a majority, then when a new primary is elected in a majority, in a new partition, then the data written to the old primary will get rolled back eventually when the partition is healed. Right? So you will have rollback of data for which you got an acknowledgement from Mongo, which is pretty bad. But there's a silver lining. The rollback is limited to 300 megabytes only. So only 300 megabytes worth of data will be rolled back. If it tries to roll back more than that, then Mongo will actually air out and say, that node will go down and say, you know, you got to do some manual recovery steps. I cannot roll back more than this amount of data. So safe, right? Safe. So even when there is a majority write concern enabled, when it's fsynced and journaled and all those things, still you can have inconsistent reads. And that is because the isolation level in Mongo is read uncommitted, which means that if client A sends a new document to Mongo and client B sends a new document to Mongo. So let's say client A added an integer 1 to a document written in Mongo, right? So it will, Mongo will write, the primary will write to its own oplog in its own index, and then it will try to replicate them to all the replicas and wait until the acknowledgement happens. But in the middle of that, if another client comes in and tries to read the value from the primary, it will give you the value which has still not been acknowledged to the actual client who wrote the value, right? So what does this mean? So this means that, let's say you have a service where you allow users to change their username or the display name, something like Twitter maybe, right? So what happens is, I change my name to X and you also try to change the name to X, which should not be allowed, right? But the primary that I wrote to went into a temporary partition. It was in the minority, right? So eventually this primary will give up its primary ownership because it is now in a partition. And the other one will assume the primary owner of that shard, the one on the other majority partition. But in the meantime, somebody comes, for example, you change your name and then you attempt to see the preferences of your account. Somebody will come and try to do a read from the old primary. He will see the new data. And if it was you who was trying to see your preference pages, Mongo might show my data to you, which is very, very bad. So in anything which requires some sort of a linearizable constraints should not be done on Mongo at all. It's just not safe under any write concern, under any sort of replication strategy. So what do we take out from this? What do we learn from this session? The first thing that we learn is network communication is flaky. If you have asynchronous communication, things are going to get dropped, they're going to get delayed, reordered, whatnot. If you decide to use a data store just by how much buzz it has, that's what I like to call as hacker news driven development, you're in for a surprise. So it's better that you find that surprise yourself first before your users find that out for you, right? So Jepsen is what you can use to test for these kind of problems. And if you want to learn Jepsen, if you already know Clojure, or if you want to learn Clojure and do some more tests, we can always use some more help testing Solr. So help us find some bugs so that I can fix them. And that's pretty much what I wanted to cover. So before I close this, I just want to say one thing, that we're going to have a Solr Lucene meetup next week on Saturday at the Target office in Manyata Tech Park. So if you guys are around and if you're free, come by. We're going to have a few good sessions. And now I open up the deck for questions. Thank you.
For Solr, I mean through Jepsen, would you also put Zookeeper as well under Jepsen? Or
yes, I do. So we tested two different topologies. In the first one, we had Zookeeper running on the host machine, which means that it is never partitioned away. In the second topology, we had 5 Zookeeper nodes co-located with 5 Solr nodes running on each of the Linux containers. So whenever there was a partition, the Zookeeper also partitioned into majority and minority. So Zookeeper actually performs pretty well. Afer himself tested Zookeeper and he gave it a clean bill of health, a good okay. So Zookeeper component sets are linearizable. Of course, it has some, because it's a consistent data store, it does have some problems with availability, but that is to be expected. And actually, it's a good thing for Zookeeper to have those problems.
So, have you tested Elasticsearch performance in case when it undergoes a bridge partition?
Yes, actually, I think one of these. Okay, so there is a bridge partition, right? The second bullet here. These are the results in case of the bridge partition. So if we tested it against random node partitions under partition halves, partition random halves, and the bridge partition, as well as he simulated a test where he tried to simulate a garbage collection pause. So he would go into the box and do a sick stop and sick continue. So it will pause the process and then unfreeze it again to simulate a garbage collection pause. And it had these data loss issues in almost all of these partitions. So it's getting better. It's definitely getting a lot better, but like for example, it had like a 29% loss in the in 1.1 and only a 3% loss in the second one. But you know, whatever is acceptable to you.